Creative Guitar Studio. Thanks for joining me for another one of my guitar lessons. This time around, we're going to be running through four tips that I've assembled to help you learn and play guitar a little bit faster, a little bit easier. Now, these ideas came out of an email that was sent in from Victor. He's out in Henderson, Nevada, and he wrote in saying, just recently, I found your YouTube channel and want to start by saying thanks. I'm a beginner to intermediate player, so I'm in that part of it all where I really want to expand my playing. What I wanted to know is if there's maybe a series of useful playing and learning tips to learn guitar faster. I'm looking for a helpful type of short list that I could follow. From Victor in Henderson, Nevada, USA. Well, thanks a lot for writing in with that email question, Victor. There's no doubt that getting better at guitar is a lot of fun. So, you know, as we feel like our skills are improving, we tend to want to go and study even more. It's pretty addictive feeling overall, and obviously it's a healthy addiction, so it's a good one. But, you know, in order to move ahead with our skills and our knowledge of the guitar, our understanding of guitar theory and other areas, we really should have some kind of a direction to follow. So in this lesson, I'll be running through my top four tips that you can start to use to help you learn guitar better and faster. So we're going to start with an overview of these four tips. All right, I'd like to begin by running through the areas that I believe are very important for helping guitarists develop much higher levels of musicianship. Now, these are all areas that are included in the Creative Guitar Studio program, and you know, within a period of time now, I'm going to start posting all of the programs on my website. We're going to start with the introductory program, where we're going to move to intermediate, and then slowly I'm going to be posting all of the advanced material on my site. So all of that stuff is going to go up eventually, and I will keep all you guys who are interested in this information posted with the results on that. But I do want to run through for this video these four points here, because these are very important for helping players develop a next level feel with their playing skills. So the first idea is having a consistency in your playing. Now, it's so important to play songs in a very consistent manner. I think one of my pet peeves of jamming with people over the last 30 years is, you know, running into those certain players who are constantly changing parts around. They're changing the way a feel is, or they're changing the way a riff is operating. Sometimes I am so curious as to why they're doing it. I honestly think that players will do that because they're just not well prepared on the parts. They haven't memorized them, and they haven't taken enough time to become familiar with how the part is supposed to operate in the song. So they're kind of changing it, and then that inconsistency, it really blows it for the band. I mean, for most of the other musicians in the band who know and are very competent with parts and understand how all the parts of the song operate, the inconsistencies from other musicians would just drive you nuts. I know it does for me. But there's more to it than that. There's also the groove. You know, the human side that has to be there. If it's not there, I mean, anyone can go and grab a computer program in a part, and you could use GarageBand or something, put it a part together, and there it is. You know, it's done, but it's a computer playing it. It doesn't have that natural ebb and flow that the human, you know, the person can add to that. So the dynamics are really important. How loud are parts? How soft are you making certain parts of the song section? All that plays a huge role. So consistency, really important, and as well the feel, you know, developing the subtle nuances of how the dynamics are operating in the piece. This is super important. Okay, the next one is having a keen sense of time. I'm always talking about this, how you need to have a very good sense of timing. My intermediate guitar program is huge on that element. So, you know, these concepts of exploring different rhythmic durations, it's just vital that you get good at that. The main ones, of course, are the quarter note, eighth note, triplet feel, and 16th note feel, even going beyond that to 16th note triplet as well as 32nd notes. Now, you don't have to get into the 16th note triplets and 32nd notes right away. In fact, I'd probably hold off on those until you have a really good handle on everything up to just standard 16th notes. But included within that would also be the variations, you know, triplet variations like the shuffle rhythm and the swing feel, and then, you know, getting into all of your different kinds of 16th note syncopation ideas as well, like your funk grooves and so forth.
But you need daily exercises, some kind of short routine, doesn't have to be long, maybe 2 or 3 minutes, where you can consistently explore different rhythmic aspects of your playing. It's super important, of course, to work with a metronome as well, with a metronome or drum machine. But you need to be going against something that has really accurate time, so you're building your own internal sense of rhythm. Next point is recognizing the notes on the neck. I think that's probably one of my other pet peeves that I have with different musicians, and especially guitar players and bass players I'll work with, who don't know notes on the neck. It just baffles me how someone can, you know, really be a decent player, but really, you know, have to just be lost on the neck, not understand anything about intervals, how scales are laid out, and how the arpeggios operate, and how different chords can be moved around, and so forth. So you want to be clear on every note location on the neck. I have some good exercises that we're going to be running through in this lesson plan for helping you with that. But, you know, you just want to know where the roots and the tonics are for all your chords and your scales, arpeggios, understand how the intervals will operate and all that stuff. It's just vital that you understand that, because it's going to make you such a better guitar player, and you'll be able to learn ideas faster if you know the notes and you know the basic theory involved in constructing everything. Last point is, once again, I'm always going on about this one too, ear training. You know, you need some kind of daily workout plan on ear training, some kind of daily exercise that are going to be helping you with understanding melody and harmony. And also there's a side of rhythm on that, but that's getting into, you know, different advanced ideas with ear training. But, you know, mainly in the beginning, early days, have a good grasp on how harmony and melody are operating. But to do that, I think it's a very simple application. Just get into the habit of singing, humming through different kinds of chord buildups, harmony buildups, scale ideas that operate as rhythmic and melodic ideas, and sing through everything. It's going to be a really strong connection to your mind, and it'll really help you connect by using your own voice, you know, to be able to just hum a part down. It's going to help you connect to the part, memorize it. It gets really well burned into your mind, so that you can grab the instrument, understand it on the instrument easier. It's just, if you can sing through something, you'll probably be able to very quickly play it. But if you don't stretch your mind in that direction, you're not going to really get great at ear training. You'll always find it difficult to retain parts in your mind while you're trying to scope them out on your guitar fingerboard. You need to have that time spent where you're doing something even simple. In the curriculum here that we're going to have for this lesson, I'm going to discuss singing through a scale of harmonized chords. Now, it's a little bit of an advanced concept, but, you know, if you are decent enough with just single tones of a scale, you can move into that, and we're going to be working through some elements of that in this lesson plan. So there's all the points that I feel are really, you know, important. They're generally lacking in a lot of guitar players that I meet: that consistency, having great feel, great sense of timing, great sense of rhythm, being able to recognize the notes all around your neck, and to work all the time consistently on ear training. And that also includes transcription. You know, if you have a tune that you think is interesting, grab your instrument and learn it, and figure out the chords, figure out the basic melody. All that kind of work is just incredible for you. So I'm going to wrap this overview portion of the video for now, and we're going to head to the studio and start breaking down some exercises for each of these points. So let's do that next.
All right, tip number one is consistency with feel. Now, if we're going to pursue learning guitar ideas and guitar skills and wanting to get them faster, one important area has to be addressed very early on, as well as always continue to be addressed through daily practice in an ongoing study routine, and that's the ability to maintain consistency along with the feel we have for our guitar parts. It's not really just good enough to learn how to play a part, you know, or learn how to play a scale or learn how to play an arpeggio. We need to have a strong and very automatic level of consistency with what we're doing. But there's also feel as well. You know, if a part's only played in a consistent manner, it's almost no different than a computer playing it. The human side, it has to be there. So, you know, this means that we need to pay attention to our dynamics, our embellishments. Maybe that's a slide or a hammer-on or a vibrato or something to make it have an overall feel. And it's okay to change those a little bit in subtle ways, but you don't want to go too crazy on the changes that you make either. Now, in example number one, I have a melodic statement that I'd like to get you to learn, and then play it, you know, really consistently until it's effortless. And then, you know, you can begin focusing on dynamics, you know, how how loud or how soft that you play each of the different notes in the melody line and all that. So, well, first of all, I want to play this down for you, give you an idea how it sounds. It goes like this, 2, 3, 4. So that's the part. Now, it's really not that difficult, and it's just kind of, you know, following some chord changes there in the key of D. So I would suggest practicing the part just initially as a melodic line, trying to get it really consistent. You could tell I was putting a little bit of vibrato in there. I was using a slide on one part. You know, just try to have that human touch, and you could tell some of the notes I was playing were a little louder. Some of them were a little bit less loud and have a little less dynamics, so pay attention to that too. And I do think it's important with studies like this to not just learn the melodic structure, but if there is a harmony that coincides, you know, go into that harmony as well. You could tell it's not a hard, you know, thing to play. You could even probably just play this with open position chords if you don't even know any of the movable chords. It's just D major, and then A to G, back to the D, and then A to E. So it's not a very difficult part, you know, but you get the chords down if they're there for you, if the part's relevant with the harmony, get the harmony together. Obviously, there's a strict melodic line here that you want to get together as well. But when you're working on playing these parts, have it as a top priority in your mind that there's consistency and you have a really good sense of feel that you've developed with the part. And that includes all the dynamics and the embellishments, articulations, all that stuff. So that's tip number one. Consistency with your feel. Tip number two is a keen sense of time. You know, the next area that I need to address here is going to be timing. Over all the years that I've taught guitar, been around musicians, you know, worked in different bands, there's one thing that always tops the list with respect to improving weak areas of skill for not just guitar players, but all musicians, and that's rhythmic sense and having great time. So if there's, you know, one area that I think will really help a player to be able to learn the foundational skills of guitar faster, it's going to be working on exercises that help to develop the skills of timing. Now, in the early days, it's going to simply require an exercise routine that explores the different rhythmic durations in music. So I put together quite a basic exercise for this in example two. All it's really going to be doing is moving through eighth notes. We're going to jump up past that into eighth note triplets, and then we're going to move into 16th notes. So what you want to do is learn the entire passage first, understand the fingering, be clear on the melody ideas, you know, get the feel, get the timing down, then turn on a metronome and work on building the speed. So let's just break this down. It's all in C major. It's going to start off around second position here with just eighth notes, counting through like this in the first measure. There's three measures we're going to work through. The first measure goes like this. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. It's as simple as that. Little sequenced idea in C major scale around second position there. Then what we're going to do next is move up into fifth position, but we're going to switch things around to eighth note triplets. So we're going to be going 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4. And you can tell it's ending there on that quarter note. Now, the next thing after that, in the third measure, the final measure, what we're going to do is shift up the neck a little higher. We're going to take it to seventh position off third string. And we're going to do a series of 16th notes now. 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4. So another sequenced idea based upon 16th notes up there. So start off like that. Count it through. Make sure you're aware of how everything's operating. Then the next phase of it all is turn the metronome on. Get mine on here at 72 beats per minute. And then we're going to practice this thing through. So here we go. 3, 4, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4. 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4. All right. So that was a quick example there of how you can execute this with your timing going on with your metronome. And you know, you notice there too, I'm counting. You know, I'm not just letting the metronome click away in the background, and I'm not just, you know, sitting there playing, you know. I'm actually counting everything out loud. And that's a huge benefit. I think if you get more of your body involved into the count, you know, sway your shoulders, move your head, tap your foot, you know, bounce your knee, everything, get your whole body moving into it, you are going to have much better time than as if you're sitting there like a statue. You know, it's just, that's not going to be the same kind of a thing. So make sure that you're really into it, you're counting, you're well aware of the beat, and that you've, before you turning on a metronome, you really know how everything's supposed to be done with the parts. You don't want to turn on a metronome if you're still just learning how everything fits together. I mean, if you don't do that, you'll just frustrate yourself, and it's not helping your time or anything. Where the timing gets aided from the use of the metronome is when you are well aware of what's going on and you fire up that metronome, get everything counted in, and you're performing, and you're really listening more so for how you're doing the parts. You know, let's say that I started into it, you know, working okay maybe with my eighth notes. But then maybe when I went into the triplets, I rushed them or something in the beginning. You know, you see that compensation as you're going through with the metronome clicking in the background of realizing that, oh, I kind of rushed that batch of triplets, or I wasn't perfect with the way I was doing the technique on maybe the 16th notes. You know, something was possibly off. So if you missed a note, or you flubbed a note or something as you were playing, there's something to be aware of. That, you know, maybe you even need to turn the metronome off and just review the part better and so forth. But get, I guess, diligent with yourself on how well that you're doing. How good is your sense of time? Are you missing? Are you rushing? Are you lagging in the time? Are you going maybe a little too slow into parts? You know, really become aware and scrutinize what's going on with it. And that is how you're going to get much better with your sense of timing. So we're going to wrap this portion up. Come back in just a moment with tip number 3. All right, tip number 3 is recognizing your notes on the neck. I think the next area here that we need to focus on is the area of practicing and becoming very well versed with the location of all the notes on the neck. Now, the guitar fingerboard is basically your roadmap to being clear on how everything you play relates into the key of the song that you're going to be playing in, or the key of the riff or the lick or whatever you're learning. So if you're clear on your note locations on the neck, it also means that you know your roots for your chords, your key notes for all your scales, and as time goes on, your knowledge for details like chord tones and intervals will all get better. They'll all be better supported over the long run. So in example 3, I have 2 drills for getting better at the notes on the neck. Example number 3A is just simply going to use octave pattern system as a map to map out the notes on the neck. Now, I'm going to use the tone of G, and what I'm going to do is just map it all out through the octave patterns. You may understand this philosophy as the caged system. It's very often taught as that. In my curriculum, I call these the pattern system, and I've got numbers that are assigned. There's 5 different patterns that we work through in my curriculum. So my curriculum follows the systems that I was taught when I was going to the Musicians Institute. So when I went to Guitar Institute of Technology, this is what they had shown me, and I just basically using the same system. Now, what we're going to start off with here is a octave jump that's going to go from the G at the 3rd fret of the 6th string, and we're going to head up to the 5th fret G on the 4th string. So that's going to be our first octave jump. Then we're going to go and carry on to the top string with that high G at 3rd fret 1st string. So we have low octave of G, upper octave of G. Then we're going to switch position, and we're going to head up the neck to the 5th fret and the 8th fret. This is going to give us an octave pattern now that's working as a 1 octave shape from the 4th string to the 2nd string. 5th fret, 8th fret. Then we're going to move up to the 8th position, and we're going to have the 10th fret of the 5th string G going over to the 8th fret 2nd string G. And again, 1 octave shape. That carries over into the 10th position, where we're going to have 10th fret G going over to the 12th fret G at 3rd string. Then after that, we're going to go to the 12th position. We're going to have 12th fret G up there at the 12th fret of the 3rd string. And we're also going to have a high G at 15th fret 1st string. We're also going to take care of the lower register, where we have that low 15th fret G on 6th string. And we have that other G there at, of course, the one we started with at the 12th fret of 3rd string. So what you want to do is get really clear on how those systems operate. It's a fantastic way for learning the notes on your neck. I'm just using my guitar pick and my middle finger to pluck the upper tone. So you could put your pick down, though, if you don't want to do it that way, and just use your thumb maybe in your second finger or something and just pluck them that way. It's up to you. You know, whatever feels comfortable. But you have a system in place where you're practicing this on a daily basis and get really good at it. You could even just, you know, keep changing notes on a daily basis. You know, I did G there, but you could shift to A, you know, do the A tone across the neck. You know, just keep working all along the guitar. Do these shapes, call out the tones as you go. Be well aware of the octave patterns, and you're going to get really good at your notes on the neck. Now, that's only example number 3A. I have another one I want to show you. This is in your handout under example number 3B. What this one is doing is it's taking care of one note, but kind of working more in a sort of a lateral and along the neck approach. I actually got this one originally just years ago from Joe Satriani. This was an exercise that he had written about in one of his columns, I believe, and there used to be a magazine in the 1980s and 90s called Guitar for the Practicing Musician, and he had a monthly article that he used to do in there, and he had this as an exercise, and I've just practiced it for ages. I thought it was a fantastic way to learn the notes on the neck. I'm going to start with E, and I'm going to use open E6 string, and then what we're going to do next is grab the next E available on the next string. So it's going to be kind of an aspect where you're going in a vertical sense across the strings. So I'm going from that E to this E here on fifth string. Then I'm going to be, of course, looking next for a note on the fourth string. So I'm going to go to the E on the second fret of fourth string. So now I've got an E on sixth, an E on fifth, an E on fourth. The next string, third string, has the E on the ninth fret. Then the second string next has the E on fifth fret. And then we've got the high E there on first string, 12th fret. And if you wanted to double back, you could even grab one more E if you wanted to. 17th fret on the second string gives you one last one if you want that one as well. You could use all of them if you wanted to. Or you could just end at 12th fret, whatever you want to do with that. Now you just, you know, pick another note, go across the strings with another note. I just did E here. But if you combine these two exercises with the octave pattern shapes that we had in exercise example 3A with example 3B's sort of more, you know, sort of vertical approach, string by string approach, whatever you want to call it, Joe Satriani's lesson, or whatever you want to refer to it as, both of these, if you do these on a daily basis, you're very quickly going to get to know the notes on the neck. But I just want to, you know, sort of plug one other idea here. If you really want to nail your notes and work on rhythm and a whole bunch of other stuff, I'm telling you, man, learn how to read music, not tab, but music notation, traditional music notation. Learn how to read it on your guitar neck. That is going to be absolutely fantastic for your knowledge of the guitar fingerboard. It will do wonders, but it's going to take a little bit more work. I know guitar players are really heavy into tab, but I'm telling you, man, if you learn how to read traditional music notation on your guitar fingerboard, it's going to be excellent. I've got a music reading program. It's a phase one program. I'm right now working on phase two. It's going to be a little more advanced reading, but I do have that available on my website. You may want to check that out. In the meantime, I'm going to wrap up here with tip three. Come back in a moment. We're going to check out tip number four, which is going to be ear training. So let's get to that next. All right, tip number four is daily work, getting daily work on ear training. Now, ear training is going to be our final idea from this list of tips to help you guys learn how to play guitar and use guitar ideas faster. And this is one of those areas, I have to say, where students will unfortunately tend to drop the ball and just kind of neglect studying altogether. It's a lot more fun to, of course, learn a lick or a riff or a part of a song that you like. But studying ear training, it can really get pushed off to the back burner. So what happens over time is that the lack of work on this really important skill will eventually lead to weaknesses developing in a lot of other playing areas. So what needs to happen is just even for a brief period as you start your practicing day, there should be a daily exercise that involves a couple of things. I think the distinction is really important between harmony and melody. So if you're not going to do a lot of ear training, at least have your ear training involve chords and harmony. Because at a lot of levels, probably unconscious levels, as you go through this, you're going to be absorbing ideas. And those ideas are going to be mainly qualities of chords. Learning to hear major and minor and diminished will be the early stages. But then as time goes on, you'll be able to hear more as you practice your training. Now, the other is in using your voice, you know, not really singing per se, but just using your voice to match pitch into discerning tones. Now, to study this, I have two exercises that apply a minor and a major harmony. Example number 4A is going to be working through an A minor harmony off of the fifth string. And all we're going to be doing is as we go through those chord types, we're going to have A minor, B diminished, C major, D minor, E minor, F major, G major, and A minor. We're going to be calling out in a matching pitch sense to those chords. So it's going to be something like this. We'll start off in A minor going A minor, and then the next one, B diminished, C major, D minor, E minor, F major, G major, A minor. So you're matching pitch as you travel along the neck. You can go down the neck with that exercise as well. A minor, G major, F major, E minor, D minor, C major, B diminished, A minor. And all I'm doing, you could tell here, it's not like I'm really matching, some kind of melodic idea. It's just the scale roots, but I'm giving my voice a chance to link up into the color of the chord. I'm telling you, if you can work on this stuff, it will do some great work for your ears and really get you tuned in better. So when you hear a chord on an album, if you're trying to transcribe a part off of a favorite recording of yours, you'll be able to start discerning that the chord is major. Maybe the chord, as you get better, the chord's maybe major 7 or minor 7, dominant 7th, maybe it's a minor 6. You'll be able to start hearing this stuff if you sing along and practice to chord changes moving in different harmonies. I have one more for you though. It's example 4B is going to move through a G major movement. So I'm going to start on a G major chord down low there, and we're going to have G major, A minor, B minor, C major, D major, E minor, F sharp diminished, G major, G major, F sharp diminished, E minor, D major, C major, B minor, A minor, G major. So you get a chance to sing along and understand how those pitches are tracking into the qualities of the chords. And it's super valuable, because one of the things you'll start noticing is if you practice this for a few weeks, you'll start to really clearly hear the sounds of major chords, minor chords, upwards into diminished. And then, as you travel through other kinds of exercises, you'll hear augmented, you'll hear dominant seventh, and so on and so forth. It's a great, easy, basic exercise. You can do it in 2 or 3 minutes at the start of your practice day. And as long as you know how to harmonize a scale, you're going to be doing fine. Now, if you don't know how to harmonize a scale yet, that alone is something that you should be working on, because you should understand how keys and harmonies work within key signatures. So I have videos online covering key signatures and diatonic work through harmony. So definitely check those videos out if you're not up to par on the ideas of harmony through keys. But otherwise, if you are, play through the harmonies like I've done so here and sing along, and you are going to have some great benefits happening in time with your ability to hear and discern notes and chord quality. Well, the study of the areas that we've covered are what I call the primary playing departments. Once we can get into a routine of practicing and, having consistent feel, developing a keen sense of time, and, once we can easily recognize the notes on the guitar fingerboard and really develop our ear to be able to hear melody and hear chord movement, we are going to be able to learn new musical ideas on the guitar very quickly. But, as you can guess, this will take time to develop. It's not going to happen overnight. You're gonna have to work on it. So start with what we cover here, but also continuously expand on these ideas as well. Make up a lot of your own exercises and studies, and over time I think you're gonna really begin to notice a lot of great stuff happening from all the work. So anyway, that brings us to the end of the video. I want to say once again, thanks for watching. Have fun working on all this information. You can download the handout and the MP3 jam track for this video over at my website. It's andrewwasson.com, and you can follow me on Twitter or like me on Facebook, or I'd also suggest subscribing to my other guitar blog update YouTube channel. There's hundreds of lesson videos on there. I put up a new lesson every Sunday, and then Monday to Thursday, I've got the popular micro lesson series. I'm almost at 300 micro lessons now, so there is just loads and loads of information on that channel to check out also. The links for all this stuff are in the description box of this video. Take care, everyone, and I will see you next time. Bye for now.